لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة قال الله تبارك وتعالى في شأن حبيبه مخبرا وآمرا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وصل عليه الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا رحمة للعالمين
Respected ulama ikram, respected elders, my dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, through the mercy and grace of Allah Almighty, we are gathered here tonight in the remembrance of Allah's beloved and our beloved Prophet Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The month that we are currently in, Rabiul Awwal, the third month in the Islamic calendar, on the 12th of Rabiul Awwal, Allah Almighty honored this world by sending the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The verses which I recited in my khutbah, Allah Almighty states, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا, that surely for you, addressing mankind, in the Messenger of Allah, you have a beautiful example, a perfect example. And usually when we hear this verse, the scholars tell us that this verse tells us that if we are to take a role model in life, which we all need, especially at our developing stages, then that role model should be none other than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now one could be forgiven to think that here we are, in the 21st century, in Britain, and the example we have is of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who grew up in the middle of Arabia, born in the 6th century. Then how can we take the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as an example? Our circumstances are completely different. The world we live in is completely different. How can we take Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as an example when the circumstances he was in, the situations he came across, the people he lived amongst were different from the ones that we do? So how do we take the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as an example? And it is true that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was different to us. It's true that his makeup, his features, his circumstances were different to us. But yet, the scholars, they have explained to us how to follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Staying on the topic of how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam differs from us. Before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was born, previous prophets were giving glad tidings of him. They were telling their followers that after me, another prophet will come. The Prophet Isa alayhi salam is mentioned in the Quran to say that a prophet will come after me and his name will be Ahmad. Other prophets, they have foretold the sending of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet, nobody told about our coming into this world hundreds or thousands of years before we were born. When we were children, we played with toys, with rattles, with toy cars. Yet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as an infant, his toy was such that he would lie in his cradle and he would look at the moon and he'd point to the moon and if he pointed his finger this way, the moon moved this way. If the Prophet ﷺ pointed his finger that way, the moon moved that way. Our toys, our toy cars, the toy of the Prophet ﷺ was the moon. How can we compare ourselves to the Prophet ﷺ? When we are children, we are a burden on people, we are a burden on our parents, our guardians, people taking care of us. It's a difficulty for them to bring us up. At times we had a headache as children. Yet, how was the Prophet ﷺ as a child? It was customary in those days in Makkah when children were born that for the first few years they'd be sent out into the deserts because the atmosphere within the city, it wasn't clean. There was a lot of pollution due to it being a city. And secondly, the language wasn't so pure. So the custom was that parents, they would send their children out with foster parents, with carers, to look after their children for a few years so that they grow strong and healthy, they pick up the pure language, and then they'll return back to their home cities and continue their life. It just so happened that the year the Prophet ﷺ was born, there was a woman by the name of Sayyidah Halima radiallahu anha. She came, again she was a foster mother, and she was looking for a child to foster. And the caravan which she came in, she was lagging behind. The animal which she had to ride on, it was weak, it was slow, and constantly people would say to her, hurry up, you're holding us back, hurry up, you're holding us back. But it wasn't her fault, she wasn't very rich. The animal she was riding on was weak. And so on the way to Makkah, her ride was holding everyone else up. Once they reached Makkah, these foster parents began looking for children that they can take back and look after. And obviously they get paid to look after these children. And whenever anyone would go to the house of the Prophet ﷺ, they'd see that he's an orphan because his father, Sayyidina Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he passed away before the Prophet ﷺ was born. And they think that he's an orphan, they probably won't be able to give as much money, let's move on to someone else. And it just so happened, all the children were taken, all the foster parents were taken, and they were Sayyidah Halima radiallahu anha, and the Holy Prophet ﷺ left. And so when she saw the Prophet ﷺ, instantly she knew that this was no ordinary child. And in fact, the fact that no one else had taken Rasulullah was a blessing in disguise for her. When she took the Prophet ﷺ on her ride and they're making their way back to where they came from, suddenly this weak and slow ride, it became powerful and fast. And all of a sudden, this animal was right at the front of the caravan. And people asked, oh, Halima, did you buy a new animal while you were in Makkah? And she said, no, what's changed is the person who is sitting on this animal. And that was none other than Rasulullah ﷺ. When we are children, we are a burden on our parents and our guardians. Rasulullah is a child and he's a blessing for his parents and guardians. Later on in the life of Rasulullah, we see that his physical makeup, his features are just miraculous and they defy logic and it's very difficult to try and understand that a human being can be like this. Once during a battle, a companion came to Rasulullah. And he had his eye in his hand, and he was struck during the battle and his eye fell out of his socket. And he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, Ya Rasulullah, my eye has fallen out of my socket. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he placed his blessed saliva on this eye and placed it back into the Sahabi's eye, into his socket. And the Sahabi says, that eye which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed in my eye, I could see better with that eye than the other one which hadn't fallen out. This is the miraculous, this is the blessings with the saliva of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Such was the makeup of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that if the Sahaba ever wanted to know which way he had gone, all they needed to do was smell. Because the fragrance Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam let off was so beautiful that whichever street he passed in, it would remain smelling nice. And the Sahaba would know that the Prophet has gone from this way, he has gone from this way, because that place was smelling so nice. Regarding the vision of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once the Prophet was leading in prayer, and after he completed his prayer, he turned around to the Sahaba and he said, "O companions, make your ruku correctly and be sincere in your prayers. For verily I can see your ruku and I can see your sincerity." And one begins to question that if the Holy Prophet is Imam and the Sahaba are praying behind him, how was he able to see their ruku? How was he able to see what is even more surprising, their sincerity? And we come to learn that even though the Prophet is facing forwards, he is aware of what is happening behind him. Not only that, but sincerity is an action of the heart. It's not something we can physically see. You won't ever see someone praying, two people praying, and then after one finishes, the other one says to him, "You weren't sincere in your prayer. You were thinking about this, you were thinking about that. You weren't focusing very much." Yet Rasulullah, he's not only aware of the physical acts of the nation, he's also aware of their sincerity, he's also aware of the state of their hearts. The Holy Prophet once performing tawaf on the Holy Kaaba. And this is just an example of his knowledge once again, which Allah Almighty bestowed him, and also his blessed character. He was performing tawaf on the Holy Kaaba, and there was a non-Muslim. At that time, a non-Muslim. Later on, he accepted Islam. And his name was Fudala. And he made an intention to martyr, to kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he had a dagger which he hid inside his cloak. And he took this dagger in his cloak and he followed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the other Muslims are also making tawaf, and he thought to himself, "As soon as I get the opportunity, I will take out this dagger, stab the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and ma'adallah, kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." So he is performing tawaf just behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, waiting for the perfect opportunity to stop him. And Rasulullah turned around and he said, "O Fudala, what are you thinking?" And Fudala radiallahu anhu says to himself that at that time, the only person, the only being who knew my intentions was Allah Almighty. I knew, Allah Almighty knew. I hadn't told anybody else. It was between me and Allah Almighty. Yet Rasulullah turned around and said, "O Fudala, what are you thinking?" And I said, "Nothing. I'm just performing tawaf. I'm remembering Allah Almighty." And so they continued doing tawaf on the Holy Kaaba. And then for a second time, the Prophet ﷺ turned around and said, "O Fudala, what are you thinking?" And he said, "Nothing. I'm just performing tawaf, doing the dhikr of Allah Almighty." And so again, for a third time, they continued doing tawaf of the Holy Kaaba. And the Prophet ﷺ turned around once again. He said, "O Fudala, what are you thinking?" And then the Holy Prophet ﷺ placed his blessed hand on the chest of Sayyidina Fudala radiallahu anhu. And Sayyidina Fudala radiallahu anhu, he explains that before the Prophet ﷺ placed his hand on my chest, the most hated person to me was Muhammad ﷺ. Once the Prophet ﷺ placed his chest on my heart, the most beloved person to me was none other than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he accepted Islam. An example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first of all, being giving that knowledge, because Fudala explains that only me and Allah knew what was happening. No one else knew my intentions, I didn't tell anyone else. Yet Allah Almighty told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about this, informed him about this. And the wisdom which Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used with that knowledge, he didn't abuse that knowledge and turn around and say to his Sahaba, "This person is going to kill me, kill him." He didn't say that. He said, he asked him three times, gave him the chance, that it was in his destiny that the Prophet ﷺ would place his hand on his chest and that person would accept Islam. And alhamdulillah, it is a great, great honor for us to be remembering the Prophet ﷺ. We are indeed privileged that we are from the Ummah, we are the followers, we are from the nation of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as I mentioned, he's someone who even before he came into this world was mentioned by people. He was foretold by prophets. and even after he has physically left this world, he is still being remembered. We can comfortably say that there isn't a moment in the day that the Prophet ﷺ is not remembered. At some point in time, somewhere in the world, the azan is being said and people are saying, Ashhadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah. At some point in time, someone is reciting the Quran and verses are referring to the Holy Prophet ﷺ. At some point in time, someone is reciting the Rushi from the Prophet ﷺ. So it's very safe to say that 24 hours a day, the Holy Prophet ﷺ is being remembered. And Alhamdulillah, Allah Almighty has chosen us in these moments to be in a gathering where the Holy Prophet ﷺ is being remembered. And indeed, we are extremely privileged to be from his nation, to be from his followers. Now moving on to the topic as to how can we act upon the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. We have had examples of how Rasulullah ﷺ was different to us, how he was an exceptional being, an exceptional creation, where Allah Almighty blessed him with so many miracles. From head to toe, the Prophet ﷺ was miracles. Now, obviously, he wasn't the same as us in that sense. But Allah Almighty at the same time explains that he is a perfect example for you. So we look into the life of the Prophet ﷺ in other aspects. How he dealt with other people. How was his character towards other people. And from that we can take lessons and we can act upon the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet ﷺ. Remember, it is not only his actions but also his sayings that include the Sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ. There was once a woman whose son had died, and she was crying over his grave. And the manner in which she was crying was against the spirit of Islam. And this is obviously something very important that we need to make ourselves aware of. That when someone does pass away, the manner in which we mourn their death should be according to Islam. Some people, they go to extremes and they begin saying things which lead to kufr. They begin saying things questioning Allah Almighty's decisions, and they cross the limits. And this is something we need to be aware of, that if we do lose a loved one or some difficulty comes upon us, we are patient, we are happy with the will of Allah Almighty, and we don't behave in such a rash manner that may even take us out of the fold of Islam. This woman, she was mourning the death of her son in a way contrary to the teachings of Islam. And so the Prophet ﷺ saw this, and he said to her, fear Allah and be patient. And because she was so angry, she was so upset, she didn't recognize that this was the Prophet ﷺ telling her. And she said, go away, you don't know what's happened to me. The difficulty that's come to me hasn't come to you. And so the Prophet ﷺ, seeing the state that she was in, she was extremely angry, she wasn't in a state to be told, the Prophet ﷺ walked off. Later on, when this woman was told, that don't you know who that was? That was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And look at how rudely you answered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when she came to know this, that this is what I've done. All of a sudden, she became, she began to repent, and she was upset about what she had done. And so she came to the house of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she was expecting to see some doorman there. She expected to see a huge palace for the Prophet ﷺ, but it was a simple house, there were no doormen there. And she came to the Prophet ﷺ and she apologized. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, I didn't know it was you, and I seek forgiveness for my actions. And the Prophet ﷺ told her that إِنَّمَا الصَّبْرُ إِنَّ صَدْمَةِ الْأُولَى, that doing sabr, doing patience, is when the calamity first strikes you. Because when the calamity strikes you, that is when it's difficult to stay patient, that's when it's difficult to stay calm. Doing patience afterwards, that's not called patience. If at the moment you get angry, you swear, you do other things, and afterwards you say I'm patient, that's not called patience. Patience is when that difficulty first comes to you, and it's hard to stay calm. To stay calm at that moment, that's what's called patience. And we see, here we see the character of the Prophet ﷺ, how he's dealing with this woman. He could have said to her that, don't you know what you've done? You've answered back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Don't you know my status, how you should speak to me? No, he saw that this woman at this moment in time, she's not in the right state of mind to be spoken to. So he let her calm down. And then afterwards, when she was in the right state of mind, he gave her some advice that in future, this is how you should behave when a calamity strikes you. And we see in the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, first of all, being so gentle with other people, and secondly, in the manner in which he conveyed wisdom. He didn't convey wisdom to show that I know better than you. He conveyed wisdom in such a way to make sure that in future, this woman wouldn't make a similar mistake. And something which is very important to us is, again, how to control our anger. Because we get angry over many things. And in our anger, we say things that we later regret, we do things that we later regret. And sometimes, in anger, you do something which can never be mended afterwards. And the Prophet ﷺ has given us the remedy of how to control our anger. How, first of all, you shouldn't, to not get angry in the first place is one thing. And then if you get angry, what you should do. And the Prophet ﷺ explained that when a person has been angry, he should read ta'awuz, a'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Because anger is one of the ways shaitan attacks people. And if you can imagine, for example, a football game, where you have two teams going out and their managers send them out. The managers, they don't send them out and say, go score as many goals as you want. That's not how football is played. Well, not nowadays anyway. What happens, the manager, he looks at the team, he looks at his own team, the strengths and weaknesses, he looks at other team, their strengths and weaknesses. He sees which players are fit enough to last the full 90 minutes, which players are strong, which ones are fast, which ones are weak. And accordingly, he adjusts his team. And during the match, constantly he's making changes, he's making substitutions, he's changing his tactics, according to how the game's going. And if he notices, right, that left back, he's got a bit of an injury. He's a bit slow, he's not that strong on the ball. So he sends instructions, go and attack the left wing. Because that part is weak, and we look to score from there. Or he notices, the central defender, he's not very good at heading. He's a bit short. So what we'll do, he'll stick on a striker who's a bit stronger, a bit taller, and he'll be able to win headers. In the same way, shaitan watches and waits for us. He observes to see where our weaknesses are. And one of the biggest weaknesses within humans is when they get angry. Because when they get angry, they're not in complete control of their senses. They'll say things that they won't normally say. They'll do things they won't normally do. And when a person gets angry, that's the perfect time for shaitan to attack. And the Prophet ﷺ has told us that when you get angry, don't let shaitan attack you. Say, A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajim. I seek repentance from in Allah Almighty from the rejected shaitan. If a person is still feeling angry, if he's standing, he should sit down. If he's sitting, he should lie down. If a person is still angry, he should perform wudu. And there are many ways the Prophet ﷺ has told us how to control our anger. And in fact, it was the character of the Holy Prophet ﷺ that was a proof for him, an evidence for him. When the people of Makkah, they asked, that, where's your evidence? Where's your proof? Where's your miracles that you're a prophet? He gave them many miracles. But one of the strongest miracles, he said to them, that for 40 years I've lived amongst you. And aren't you the people who have given me the title of As-Sadiq, the truthful, and Al-Amin, the trustworthy? Aren't you the same people who entrust me with your goods? The people of Makkah, even the non-Muslims, whenever they went on a long journey and they needed to leave precious belongings behind, they leave it in the Prophet ﷺ. And he was telling them that the fact that you give me these things to look after, isn't that enough evidence for you? The fact that I spent 40 years amongst you, isn't that enough evidence for you? And it was the character of Rasulullah ﷺ that was one of his evidences. Now, one other aspect of Rasulullah ﷺ, because whenever we think of the Messenger of Allah, we think of his teachings, we think it's very serious, it's always being serious, it's always about having a straight face and so on. Yet Rasulullah had his humorous side as well. And he explained how we should joke, how we should be involved in humor. And that this humor, it shouldn't be foul, it shouldn't be vile, it shouldn't include lying or insulting people. There was once an old woman who came to the Prophet and she said, Ya Rasulullah, pray to Allah Almighty that He grants me Jannah. And we see this, the understanding of the Sahaba that they would come to Rasulullah asking for Jannah. She said, Ya Rasulullah, pray to Allah Almighty that He grants me Jannah. And the Prophet said, O mother, no old woman is going to go to Jannah. And she began to cry. She thought to herself, if the Prophet is saying no old woman is going to Jannah, what chance do I have? And she's really upset and she's about to go away. And the Prophet stopped her and he said, that's because everyone who enters Jannah will be a youth, will be in their youth, will be someone young. And so she became extremely happy. to know that she will enter Jannah, that there is a chance for her to enter Jannah. And that when she enters it, she won't be an old woman, she will be a young woman. And the teaching of the Prophet ﷺ, just to finish up, again, not only his teachings, not only his actions, but also his character, his makeup is something which we should all attempt to follow. And having love for the Prophet ﷺ, having love for his sunnah, is an essential part of our iman. And if we are unable to follow the sunnah, for example, any sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, then at least have love for that sunnah. At least have in your heart that inshallah one day I will follow this sunnah. My weakness is my circumstances, whatever. But we should never ever, anything that is ascribed to Rasulullah ﷺ, think of it as derogatory, think of it as something low. Actually, we should think that this is the sunnah of Rasulullah ﷺ, this is the companion of Rasulullah ﷺ, this is the family member of Rasulullah ﷺ, and because of this link it has to the Holy Prophet ﷺ, we should have respect for it. There was a Sahabi who once asked Rasulullah ﷺ about the Day of Judgment and how the proceedings will take. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, I don't have much fasting. I haven't made many prayers. I haven't given much in charity. But I love Allah and I love His Messenger. And the Holy Prophet ﷺ told him that on the Day of Judgment, you will be raised with the ones you love. And if we love and show love for the Holy Prophet ﷺ, in our hearts, have love for Rasulullah ﷺ, for his teachings, for the book which he brought, for his companions, for his sunnahs. And inshallah ta'ala, on the Day of Judgment, we will also be raised with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I pray that Allah Almighty, He gives us all the tawfiq to take as much blessings from this blessed month, from this gathering, and He gives us all the tawfiq to follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ameen wa ma'alayna illa billah.